Hello, everybody. Good evening, good afternoon, good morning. I'm absolutely delighted to be moderating this very interesting launch of the Food Systems Innovation Hub Initiative by Sight and Life Foundation. A brief word of introduction on myself. I am Simon Winter. I am the Executive Director of the Syngenta Foundation for Sustainable Agriculture. We share a lot of synergies with the Sight and Life Foundation, not least of which is that we're both headquartered in Basel in Switzerland, where I'm speaking to you from today. But we also share a vision of the holistic nature of the food systems. And we are at the beginning of, I think, what will be a very momentous year for advancing inclusion and sustainability within the global food systems, with the UN Food System Summit taking place later this year. And it's very important for us as a foundation, as it is for Sight and Life, that we look very holistically at how to strengthen food systems. And that holistic approach has two main dimensions to it, from my perspective. One is it needs to be right along the value chain. Sight and Life Foundation is particularly interested, as you'll hear in the course of this session, in nutrition, in consumption, in diets, and so on. But that food needs to be supplied, and it hopefully is supplied locally and hopefully in a sustainable way by farmers who can benefit from advances on the market end of the value chain. So this holistic approach needs to look right along the value chain, but it also needs to look broadly, horizontally, at what is coming in to strengthen those food systems in the form of innovations, in the form of behavior change by consumers, behavior change by intermediaries, and behavior change by producers. It needs to be done in a way that is sustainable, not only from a consumption perspective, but also economically, environmentally, and socially. And it requires strong business models that can then attract finance in order to grow those business models and scale the adoption of those innovations and the consequent impacts, whether those impacts are in terms of consumer impacts, intermediary impacts, job creation impacts, farming impacts, and so on. So we're very aligned and very excited to be supporting this initiative and contributing to the strengthening of innovation within food systems from our foundation perspective. So enough about me, let's move on to the afternoon. A quick heads up, this event is being recorded. If you don't want to be recorded, then you should leave at this point, but hopefully that's fine. We will be making the recording available via YouTube on February the 2nd. When you are in the call and want to comment, please do so in the Q&A, and please make sure that your name is clearly there, and you can rename yourself to add your organization as well if you haven't already done so. We'll start with a number of plenary presentations. During those plenary presentations, please put comments and questions in, but we will only be able to answer those later. We also have measures in place to maintain the integrity of the call. Should there be a disturbance, please bear with us and we'll restore order shortly. Without further ado, let me get on and introduce our keynote speaker and host for today, Dr. Klaus Kraemer, who is the Managing Director of Sight and Life Foundation. Sight and Life is a nutrition think tank. Klaus is also an adjunct associate professor in the Department of International Health at Johns Hopkins in the Bloomberg School of Public Health. Sight and Life informs, supports, designs, and incubates evidence-based malnutrition solutions at the convergence of the public and private sectors. It's ideally positioned to catalyze innovation and much-needed collective action in nutrition. And by leveraging the strengths and capacities of both industry and public sector partners, it can address societal nutritional goals. and deliver value to food and nutrition insecure populations. Sight and Life works with a unique diverse set of diverse partners on some of the toughest challenges in nutrition, using scientific evidence to change the way nutrition is delivered to people who need it most. Klaus is also an author. He edits the Sight and Life magazine and has published about 150 scientific articles, monographs, reviews, and book chapters, as well as co-editing 12 books and being the co-inventor of more than 20 patents. Klaus, over to you.
Thank you, Simon. Dear fellow champions of food systems, we are really so delighted to have you here today with us to discuss such an important topic as improving the delivery of quality food for the food systems. Next slide, please. Today, our planet is hot, hungry, and crowded. Rising temperatures, depleting resources, and underperforming food systems are key contributors. With such rising stress on our planet and our diminishing ability to nourish our people, we face an unprecedented global health crisis for the future of our planet's custodians. Our children will bear the brunt of the situation. Now, you may be asking yourself how we can holistically address these challenges and bring multiple approaches and solutions to address these global crises together into one cohesive strategy. Adding to this challenge is the complexity of food systems, each unique to the geography and culture it is supposed to nourish. Therefore, a one-size-fits-all solution clearly does not exist, and the approaches used by high-income countries cannot be expected to work in the same way for low- and middle-income countries. To end all forms of malnutrition, we must enable a societal dietary shift towards healthier, environmentally friendly food systems that are local, resilient, and responsive. Our aspiration is that the transformation of failing food systems lies in innovation hubs. Operating in various locations, they will be able to mold themselves to the needs of their specific countries and communities by engaging directly with its people, its culture, its entrepreneurial talent, and its unique climate. Next slide, please. This will be achieved by focusing on three key actions: inspire, invest, and innovate. Starting with inspire. The Food Systems Innovation Hub will encourage existing exceptional food and technology companies with market prowess and entrepreneurs to expand into the Global South, grow market interest, align with a range of investors, and develop and test new products. Just imagine nutritious crops such as teff in Ethiopia aggregated in one place on thousands of smallholder farmers, then milling on a large scale. This would potentially make the teff affordable to low-income consumers while also producing a safer and more nutritious product by eliminating anti-nutrients and aflatoxin and fortifying during processing. Invest. The Food System Innovation Hubs will facilitate investment in local companies that have the potential to scale, as well as in technology transfer, nutrition, food safety, and consumer studies to prove market viability and show latent existing demand for nutritious food. For example, farmers in Kenya currently indicate a willingness to use climate-smart approaches such as insects for animal feed to produce nutrient-dense animal protein. Impact evaluations may convince other entrepreneurs to enter the market or broker a partnership between a global insect feed manufacturer and a local feed company. Innovate. The Food System Innovation Hubs will stimulate innovation throughout the value chain tailored to lower middle-income country markets by drawing additional investment into scaling up new technologies, which will be incredibly impactful to small and medium-sized enterprises and startups that dominate food production in the Global South. Small and medium-sized enterprises also face unique constraints compared to their peers located in high-income countries. For instance, a fully automated temperature sensing insect control greenhouse may not save on costs in the Netherlands, where energy and skilled labor are relatively cheap, but would be unprofitable in West Africa, where backup electric generators and replacement parts are far more costly. The next slide, please. With our deep knowledge in nutrition science and extensive experience in developing malnutrition solutions, over the past three decades, we believe the Food Systems Innovation Hub is needed and will provide at least 8 transformative outcomes shown in this slide. The next slide, please. However, for the Food System Innovation Hub to be successful, collective action must come from the private sector, governance, impact investors, development partners, and UN agencies in catalyzing innovation through a range of services. I will expand on this and the outcomes towards the end of the workshop. Next slide, please. You may now be asking, where might these food system innovation hubs be located? We have identified a few countries with rapidly developing economies where there is a thirst for adopting innovations in Asia and Africa. The last slide, please. Food systems innovation hubs are a bold and new initiative. Therefore, we welcome you to bring your unique skills and resources to help these unique challenges. Thank you.
Great. Thanks very much, Klaus. Let's swiftly then move on to our first guest speaker, Dr. Charles Karangwa. Dr. Karangwa is the Acting Director General of the Rwanda Food and Drugs Authority. Before his nomination, he was a senior lecturer of toxicology in general medicine and pharmacy at the University of Rwanda. He's also the founder and co-promoter of the University Laboratory of Analysis of Foodstuffs, Medicines, Water, and Toxicants, known as LADAMET, which has a unique ability to lead enterprises, government, and other public and private sector entities to achieve their goals, as well as to garner critical attention for work being done in the domain of medicines, foods, toxicants, as well as water. Dr. Karangwa's areas of interest include assessing human exposure to chemicals and more especially chemical and biological toxicants. And he has many publications in peer-reviewed journals. Dr. Karangwa, you're welcome, over to you.
Thank you so much for the opportunity to present on a Food System Innovation Hub, especially mentioning African challenges. And when you look at report worldwide, especially WHO, we are recording 2.6 million of children who are dying due to malnutrition worldwide annually. And there is a need to have a strong food system innovation hub, especially when the food commodity becomes a global business with all associated hazard. And of course, the problem of lack of accurate data on food industry in Africa. Many challenges in Africa are bringing to have a broken food system and a limited access to global market. First of all, when you look at the people handling the food, there is a large number of small scale farmers and the middlemen and of course they are lacking enough finance and skills. Of course, they are lacking also modern technology that can allow them to go to global market. Other problem for African countries, inefficient policies and a lack of strong governance. And of course, that can limit their product to be international markets. For Rwanda, why Rwanda need to be one of countries to host a food system innovation hub? Because of many factors. One, we have a strong regulation of food. And of course, Rwanda have a compiled of strategy in national strategy for transformation, highlighting priority for food safety. Another aspect is Rwanda being one of common market in Africa. We mentioned African continental free trade area. We have been championing and a member of East African community, ECOWAS and COMESA. Those are an opportunity that can have can host a hub for Eastern and Central Africa, adding good governance, political willing, and a strengthening and a food system in secondary city, which is a project we are working with the Sight and Life. And we are going for digital and being a bilingual, Francophone and French speaking countries. This is another added value. Thank you so much.
Great, thanks so much, Dr. Karangwa. It's now my great pleasure to turn over to the Asian region and introduce Dr. Pawan Agarwal. Dr. Agarwal is the Special Secretary for Logistics in the Ministry of Commerce and Industry and has been so since May 2020. Previously, he was the Secretary in the Department of Consumer Affairs and the Ministry of Consumer Affairs. And also before that, the Chief Executive Officer at the Food Safety and Standards Authority of India from 2015 to 2020. He has a distinguished academic background, was a visiting scholar and fellow at ICREA in New Delhi and the University of Melbourne, has published on a range of issues in education, skills development, food and nutrition, and was the author of the book, Indian Higher Education Envisioning the Future, published in 2009. Dr. Agarwal, over to you. Thank you.
So thank you, Simon, for the nice introduction. And thank you, Sight and Life Foundation, for the opportunity that you have given me to be on this panel. The Food System Innovation Hub is a wonderful idea. And India is perhaps the right place to have one such innovation hub, because a lot of innovation and experimentation on food system transformation is already happening in India. As you may be aware, a country with 1.38 billion people, you know, it is size of a continent, and the food system is still evolving in India. It is in a transition phase with a large unorganized informal sector. Small and petty businesses, they dominate the food landscape. And therefore, you know, food safety administration becomes a key challenge. And in this regard, the Food Safety and Standards Authority of India, of which I had the privilege to lead for 4 years, had adopted a rather unusual approach to food safety management, wherein consumers come first, focused around behavioral change, you know, changing and empowering them to understand what food is safe and what food is not safe, and making a difference to the demand for demanding safe food from businesses. The second pillar of the unusual approach that India adopted was focus on small and petty food businesses, you know, and large scale training and capacity building efforts, ratings of small and petty food businesses, and incentivizing them through these ratings so that they begin to do the right things. The third area of focus was around partnerships for public purpose, you know, creating an ecosystem of private partners in food testing and training and capacity building and hygiene rating that supported and co-regulated the entire food safety sector in the country more effectively. And the last area of our unique approach was fostering seamless integration of our efforts towards food safety management with nutritious food and sustainable diets, and scaling up our initiatives through the mainstreaming of these activities with the other government programs. The experience of India is very relevant to other low and middle income countries that could follow and adopt similar approaches, since they too have large informal sector and their food systems in those countries is in transition. So a food innovation hub in India can build on these innovations and further accelerate process for transforming food systems across the world, particularly in low and middle income countries. Thank you.
Dr. Agarwal, thanks very much indeed. So back to Ndidi. Ndidi is also the founder and chair of nourishingafrica.com, which is envisaged as a home for 1 million entrepreneurs transforming the Africa's food and agriculture landscape. She also is the co-founder of Ace Foods, which sources from over 10,000 farmers and produces a range of packaged spices, seasonings, and cereals. And she serves on many boards, including that of the Rockefeller Foundation, Agra, and Nigerian Breweries, which is part of the Heineken Group. Ndidi, over to you.
Thank you so much, Simon. It's really a pleasure and a privilege to be here. And I congratulate Sites at Life for this innovative hub and for prioritizing the African continent. Happy New Year to you all. I've only been given 5 minutes, so I'll try to run through really quickly. I got into the agriculture and food landscape because this picture followed me around the world, starving African children as the face of Africa. This made me very angry because Africa is naturally endowed for agricultural excellence, and there's no reason why as a continent we should be net importers of food or have such high rates of malnutrition, or why when we look at the cost of food on our continent, many of our countries, including mine, Nigeria, lead from behind, where 56% of household income is spent on food. So I started a range of organizations, Sahel Consulting, which works across Africa, transforming the agriculture and nutrition landscape, Ace Foods, which Simon mentions, an agro-processing company, and most recently, Nourishing Africa. And through my work over the last 12 years, exclusively focused on the agriculture and food system, and over the last 25 years in international development, I've identified that there are real challenges that many entrepreneurs face on the African continent. And yet we have so many promising trends. And this is one of the beauties of a hub, is that it will address the critical realities around climate change, around post-harvest losses, around the regulatory environment, the gender inequity, but also capitalize on the promising trends such as digitization, which allows for leapfrogging, technology innovations, hopefully will engage young people and focus on equity. We started Nourishing Africa in the midst of COVID because we believe that the private sector in Africa has to drive Africa's food agenda and address the challenges in the food ecosystem. And I also spent last year working on a book which is focused on food entrepreneurs in Africa and enabling them to scale. And I'll just share some key insights from the book because I think this is critical as we shape the future of the hubs that we envisage. For entrepreneurs in Africa to really drive the food ecosystem transformation we require, they need demand-driven business models with measurable value addition. They need to leverage innovation and technology. They need to shape the ecosystems. They need cost-efficient and dynamic systems and structures, which is so important for the hub to share. They need simple and compelling branding. And finally, but most importantly, embedded in their DNA, they have to be able to adapt to climate change, mitigate risks and shocks like COVID-19, and ensure resilience. So as I round up, I want to share some key insights that are critical as you think about this hub for the African continent to ensure availability and accessibility of nutritious food and affordable nutritious food. And there are some key practical steps that I want you to consider. First, I think Dr. Agarwal talked about it. We need to build strong partnerships. No hub will work in isolation. We need partners in finance, nutrition, gender, climate, manufacturing. We need to put private sector at the heart of every single innovation and hub, because ultimately this is what's sustainable, this is what is already feeding people, and this is what will ensure that we succeed. We need to ensure the commercialization of research. Too often there's great research in our institutions that never filters into the markets, and we don't need more research, we need market-driven commercial research that makes a difference. We need to invest in talent. And these hubs should be run by Africans, for Africans with homegrown talent. We need to unlock catalytic and patient capital to de-risk investments so that what comes out of the hub actually comes to market. And finally, we need to leverage existing platforms. My dream is that when you think of Africa, you don't think of the starving child. You think of these children who are well-nourished, who live full and meaningful lives, and who achieve their highest potential. And I'll end with a quote which motivates me. It's actually a Tibetan quote, which says, if I tell you my dream, you might forget it. if I act on my dream, perhaps you'll remember. But if I involve you, it becomes your dream too. This is the essence of partnership. Building a hub or building hubs across the world, across the continents that share knowledge, share insights, but actually commit to involving as many people who are ready and able to achieve the dream. Thank you so much.
First of all, we're going to get straight to our distinguished panelists and their views on the topic of food systems innovation hubs. And Amar, if you're there, please put your video on as well. Great, thank you. So first of all, I'm gonna start with Erthrin Cousins. Erthrin, as a former executive director of the United Nations World Food Program, and now in your current status at Stanford University Center on Food Security and Environment, as a fellow of agriculture at the Chicago Council on Global Affairs, and as an impact fund leader, how do you see the role that Food Systems Innovation Hub could play from these various perspectives that that you come from? Thank you.
Well, thank you so much for that question, Simon. And thank you to Sight and Life for having me as a participant in this very important panel this morning. That's an interesting question for you to ask me because my perspective, I guess, may be a little different from other members of the panel because I look at it from how do we ensure access to nutritious food for the most vulnerable populations. It's not just about creating new agricultural ventures, but from my perspective as having served as the executive director of the World Food Program and recognizing that we won't achieve our shared goal of ending hunger and provide ensuring access to nutritious food unless we ensure that everybody has access and that we're not just bringing solutions online that are beneficial to those who can afford it, but ensuring that everyone can afford the nutritious solutions that we bring online to make food more affordable, and that we use the opportunity to build these new businesses to support economic growth and job creation. So the thinking about the hubs in that light, I get very excited because the hubs have the potential to ensure that we can capture the ingenuity of those who live in Africa and India in particular, we're talking about today, because too often you have entrepreneurs with the capacity to build businesses that will address the challenges that I've just identified, yet they lack the access to the operational capacity building support, the partnerships that are necessary, the support for the policy changes that are required, as well as one of the most important issue, I would argue, if, when you have all of these others intact, is also the capital. The reality is that while the investment in ag tech and innovation has increased globally, in India and Africa, those numbers are far too low for the number of entrepreneurs that are coming online. And I'll just wrap up by saying that the only aspect of the hubs that we've not spoken about is how do we ensure that all of the hubs, the accelerators, the incubators, as well as the centers of excellence are talking to one another so that we can ensure that all of the knowledge that we are building is shared across those leaders working with companies across the continent as well as in India.
Great, Erthrin, thank you very much for those good thoughts. And I really like your sort of and I actually would be surprised if it is that misaligned with the other panelists, your very holistic kind of vision. But let's go now to Maya Stewart, who is a successful entrepreneur working to actually improve the food system as an entrepreneur. Maya, from your perspective, what do you see the needs of young entrepreneurs who do want to develop more affordable, nutritious, tasty, and culturally relevant foods? And how could a food system innovation hub really help you and other enthusiasts who want to contribute to transforming the food system?
Thank you, Simon. And thank you, Site and Life, for giving me this opportunity to talk as well. To answer your question, Simon, for me, when I think of youth, I mean, I think of the power to leverage technology towards achieving social and now economic goals. Previously, technology was known as just a simple communication tool that was used to just drive, you know, simple business activities. But right now, it's being used to leverage so many activities in different spaces, not only in the tech world, but also specifically right now in the farming environment. So when I think of this, I'm now thinking in terms of the food systems, I'm thinking digital innovation is something that we need to really address. And in the question of how do we sort out affordability? Affordability is basically a case of understanding the costs within the value chain and how to minimize these costs. We understand that food gets expensive as it moves up the value chain, and innovative thinking can be able to reduce these costs through digitizing the processes. So that's why I'm thinking, if we have to think, how do we encourage the youth to come on board? We need to digitize the entire process. We need to forego our previous way of doing farming or doing the business model of, you know, the farmers come together, they put their stock in one place, and then they wait for a driver to come and pick it up. They negotiate with them or a trader and then send it to the final consumer. The farmers need to know who their buyers are and vice versa. I myself would like to know where I'm getting my produce from, because if I have a chance to order more, I'd like to know I can get that feedback right away, you know, directly from the source. So we need to employ different models such as blockchain or just simple mobile apps. I've seen like different countries have employed different simple technologies that are helping the entire value chain, making the process so much cheaper. A good example of this is Twiga Foods that is being used in Kenya, putting the farmers in touch directly with their, you know, with their end users. In this particular case, it could be restaurants, it could be supply store chains and so forth. So when it comes to nutrition, again, you need to think digitally. Right now, if I want to take a look at a recipe for, you know, I've maybe got chicken in my fridge, I go online, I go into Pinterest or I go onto TikTok and I look for different recipes and try to follow the different steps. So in the same light, if we are trying to look at it from a cultural perspective, we need to try and embrace our different food culture and see how can we marry it with what is right now the modern way of cooking or the modern recipes that are coming or the modern styles of cooking that are coming up right now. If there's a way that we can embrace this, we can definitely put in you know, cultural relevant foods into our different menus that we see on our plates every day. And a very good example in Malawi is where we see a lot of people using the locally available tilapia, which is called chambo. And this is a fish that's only found in Malawi, but if you go to any restaurant in Malawi, you will find it. Before you find any other kinds of fish, whether it's hake or some other forms of fish that are mostly imported. And it's created its own movement. So wherever you go to a hotel or restaurant, or even into the storefronts, the first fish you see is going to be the local chambo tilapia. So it's easy to grow it as well, which makes it relevant when it comes to food system transformation. And the challenges, you know, of trying to address how do we make sure a readily available food, it's there. We just have to see how can we bring it into the front line, make our locally available foods more attractive above and beyond what is not known as the Western foods. So when it comes to now, how do we make the, you know, the actual youth or anybody who's an enthusiast you know, to join this hub? What are the positives of these hubs? For me, I look at a hub, you know, basically like a safe space where like-minded enthusiasts can come together, share ideas, share their experiences. And for me, I would like to be in a hub to learn new skills, to solve the different challenges that I've got. This is the place that I assume I'll go and get these solutions, especially locally, you know, locally adaptable solutions. There's the question that was mentioned, how do we bring the different players, whether it's the incubators, whether it's, you know, the accelerators and the like, they may come up with different solutions, but then if you bring them all together to this one hub or to this many hubs, you come in and have these general discussions, people can be able to adapt the different solutions that they've seen working in another country or in another space and making it work specifically for that country. So in short, I think we need to make the youth excited about farming. And one of the ways to do this, again, is through these hubs. And these hubs, from what I've experienced in different hubs and accelerator hubs that I've also been invited to, is the inclusivity of digital technology. It makes it more attractive. It makes farming more attractive. And I think we can be able to solve the challenge of food systems through this model. Thank you.
Excellent, Maya. That's a fantastic response. I think you really articulated so clearly the opportunities for accessing global technologies, talents, knowledge, support, etc., at the same time as making it culturally very relevant and very locally engaged. And then creating a network for farmers, for entrepreneurs, and so on to be able to leverage through this sort of notion of the integrated hub that probably isn't something that's readily available at the moment with more isolated initiatives underway. So thank you. That's a very compelling vision. I'm moving over now to Amar Ali. Amar, as the former CEO of Africa Improved Foods and now the first president of DSM in Africa, can you tell us about how you approach developing a truly sustainable food value chain in Rwanda? And how you put nutritious foods at the core of the value proposition for AIF. And then how does a food system innovation hub help in the future for others who wish to set up a sort of holistic and integrated business such as AIF?
Yeah, so with AIF, I think the key thing was playing across really most areas of the value chain. So we stretched right back to the farm gate. So we were sourcing directly from 35,000 plus smallholders with a new pretty innovative grain collection model that minimizes the effects of aflatoxin. So we were kind of went pretty heavy on the sourcing capability. Also processing and quality was our core capability, and DSM is very strong in that as well. But then also on the demand side. So working with big buyers like the WFP, also like the government of Rwanda, but also the commercial market, so getting closer and closer to the consumer, focusing on tailored solutions. So what worked in Rwanda didn't quite work the same way in Kenya, so we needed to get closer to the Kenyan consumer, and likewise in Uganda. So I think with AIF, it was about having the right set of partners, both shareholders and other partners like the WFP and the government of Rwanda, as well as the right kind of ambition and patience to build across those different areas of the chain. Your second question was around how would I see innovation hubs helping other. Yeah. So, I think if you look at all the things that need to happen just at the broad level, if you look at all the things that need to happen to take the food system here from where it is to where it needs to be, a lot of boxes need to get ticked for any given product that's going to market. So, you know, it needs to be affordable, it needs to be nutritious, needs to be climate smart, both in its production methods and in, you know, the opportunity cost of what that land and water could have been doing. It needs to be aspirational from a consumer point of view, and it needs to create livelihoods. So there's a lot of different boxes to tick. And if you want to tick all those boxes, innovation is needed because otherwise you end up, it's very easy to start making kind of fairly big trade-offs saying, well, okay, yeah, but you know, well, let's just leave that one to the side kind of thing. But it's the leaving that one to the side sort of mentality over the last 20, 30, 40, 50 years that sort of led us to where we are. And I think it's now a bit all of the above needs to be happening right now when you look at the numbers to get us back on track. And so to do that, I don't think we can only, we need to, but I don't think we can only be taking what's happened in other parts of the world or what's happened in the past and trying to replicate that here in Africa. We need to be looking at genuine innovation. So, you know, doing something completely different to reduce the cost of protein or reduce the cost of maize, to build a value chain in eggs, which is sorely needed, or the aquaculture chains, you know, to shift to more sustainable proteins. And yeah, I don't think just transplanting what's happened, you know, in Europe or the US or Asia is going to do it. So I think there's a really important and really sorely needed role for innovation of the kind of cross-sectoral nature that you that you're talking about, and I think it will really facilitate you know, future companies, hopefully, that we as DSM will be involved in as well, to moving this continent forward.
Great, Albert, thank you. Thanks for sharing your experience and also your perspective on this need, really, to have things that are invented here rather than elsewhere at the heart of these more integrated solutions that can not leave things behind, as you said. Great. I'm moving now to Brita Gavin-Smith. Brita, you've worked in public health and nutrition for nearly 20 years in both public and private sectors. Most recently, through Sight and Life, you've been engaged with SMEs in Ghana and in Rwanda, helping them engage in the fight against malnutrition. So where do you see the Food Systems Innovation Hub playing a role in helping you with your goals?
Well, I think if we're talking about engagement, something that everyone's talked about so far, we're definitely asking a lot at the moment of the food system and its actors, right? So it's a big wish list. We're saying we want to increase availability of affordable food, and that food should be nutritious. We want to increase demand. We want to improve livelihoods through investment in SMEs. We talk about enhancing regulations, standards, improving monitoring and testing. So I think engagement will be key, but I think it needs to be looked at from two different perspectives regarding what the role of the Food Systems Innovation Hub could be. So the first part of this engagement, we should look at the how. So how do we bring actors in the food system at both the local and the global level together? If you imagine a family meeting, right, you may not like all your family members or you agree or don't agree with them, but they all need to be at the table to make a decision that you can act on. So how do you bring everyone to the table? Like any behavior change, it's about an exchange. I think, for example, we often talk about public-private partnerships, impact investors, Esther mentioned that earlier, and government collaboration coming together within the context of a robust entrepreneurial culture as being essential. But this engagement is very complex and it requires thoughtful incentives to work effectively and to encourage people out of their silos. I think the Food Systems Innovation Hubs can create a big enough platform that enables us to create these incentives that make actors come together and make them want to come together to work towards transformation in the food system. For example, government policies eliminating subsidies for nutrient-poor foods can provide incentives to produce more nutritious and also affordable food. Tax incentives for companies willing to share technologies, for example. And then the second part of this engagement piece, which also was touched on earlier by some of the panelists, is about joining the dots. I think the more at Sight and Life we talk to farmers, young people, SME owners, entrepreneurs working in the food industry, we see that there's actually a lot happening and there's a lot of innovation, both at the local level and at the global level. We're seeing a lot of other hubs emerging. So the Food Systems Innovations Hub can help bring together other hubs, identifying the gaps, sharing the knowledge and learnings from what's currently happening, so that's accessible for those working across the food chain and the areas that need it most. So I think we need to think more broadly regarding the systems hubs about these two different parts of engagement. And I'm sure we get a chance to talk about it a little bit more throughout the discussion today.
Great, thanks, Brita. Kavanagh, I'm gonna pick up on Brita's last point about this, I wouldn't say yet plethora perhaps, but certainly increasing number of similar sounding things around hubs for innovation. I think linked to, in particular, this desire that we're seeing for scaling of innovation to be adopted by consumers, by producers and other intermediaries. And that's very much in line with the Food System Summit. So how do you see this particular initiative that you want to pursue as different from those other hubs? And In particular, how do you see it being managed, governed, and who should be playing a leadership role?
Thank you, Simon. You highlight an important area for us to think through, especially given the plethora of innovation hubs that we've been seeing in the news recently. But maybe first, I'll tackle the first part of the question, which is, what are these innovation hubs that we see out there? And then comes the second part of what is it that we can do together, especially those as a complement nutrition domain. The first part is that we see a range of different types of archetypes of innovation hubs, both in sub-Saharan Africa and South Asia. And the word archetype itself means that there is no one size fits all, that is, there is no standard innovation hub. And today we're discussing hubs that will keep nutrition at the center stage of food innovation. And to be able to achieve our shared ambition sooner, it would be pragmatic to look at existing archetypes in the countries and collaborate with these hubs that already exist, depending upon the country's readiness for innovation. And such a collaboration could be either in the form of a virtual space or a physical space. So the first type, let me talk a bit about the first type, the virtual hubs. They're quite exciting because when there is low funding to get us started, or in countries where the infrastructure to support an innovation ecosystem is underdeveloped. And in such virtual platforms and communities, one can network, get trained, access knowledge, or even capital from anywhere in the world. We didn't get to see our last guest presenter, but you'll have access to the video later on for all the participants. Our last guest presenter, Ndidi from Sahel Consulting and Nourishing Africa in Nigeria, she's leading some early efforts for setting up a virtual hub in Nigeria in the agri-food SME space, to which we can plug nutrition into the entire discussion around innovations, food innovations. And another good example of a virtual hub in Africa is Partners in Food Solutions, which support a range of agri-food SMEs. And when it comes to physical spaces, we see three different archetypes. Specifically, a lot of them are quite active in South Asia, but also lower and upper middle income countries in Sub-Saharan Africa. And these are usually in countries that have already made targeted investments through industrial policies, such as there are government-led science and technology parks. They offer infrastructure for companies to locate, network, and grow. And the third archetype are universities, where research-led incubators offer not only infrastructure, but also talent for companies, startups to tap into. And the fourth type comes from the private sector. We see venture capitalists, impact investors, but also food companies running programs called accelerators, especially for startups to take innovations to scale. And finally, the fifth archetype that we see is something called the node. It's usually seen in the global north in a range of sectors. And nodes are central points in the innovation ecosystem that facilitate networking, collaboration, and learning. And a prominent example for us to work with is the Food Valley in Netherlands, which acts as the global coordination secretariat for a worldwide network of food innovation hubs. And recently, together with the World Economic Forum, they initiated a global network where farmers are placed at the head of the table for systems change. And that is probably an answer to what Ertrun had raised in her comments, that how are the hubs talking to each other? We need nodes like the World Economic Forum or the Food Valley Netherlands to share learnings, but also collaborate. So looking at this collectively, I think these five possible archetypes, and there could be more, we can advance a holistic systems approach to innovation. And initially, the governance and the managers of such hubs could be who are already a part of any of these five archetypes, and we start thinking about plugging in nutrition into their conversations.
Great, thanks, Governor. So if I hear you correctly, there's the growing plethora, whether it's a plethora or not yet, is actually to be welcomed, because there is space for lots of different types of mechanisms that can really bring innovations together with capacities with finance, et cetera, all these things that they need. And then there's this kind of networked overlay that you just alluded to, which I think is going to be incredibly important. So the more the merrier, it sounds like, from your perspective, at this point in time, at least, which is great. Okay, I'm going to turn to the first question that we got from the Q&A that has received some good votes, and a reminder to everybody to go through the questions in the Q&A and vote for your favorite ones so we can make sure that they are answered. The first question is how will this affect food safety? And I presume that this is, Robin, is the concept of the Food System Innovation Hub. How does food safety get integrated into the hubs overall? Maybe I can start with Maya, because I imagine as an entrepreneur, you're worried about food safety. Maybe others then want to comment on this as well. Maya.
Sorry, Simon, you cut off there. Please repeat the question.
Yes, so the question is, how do you think about food safety, and how, in your idea, would food safety be considered within the Food System Innovation Hub?
That's a very good question. I mean, if I was going to answer it, I'm actually offline. If I was going to answer it from my own personal experience, food safety requires a lot of players to be involved. Whether it's coming from the production all the way up to final processing point. When it comes to post-harvest losses, there's quite a lot of issues regarding food safety. I believe somebody also mentioned from DSM in Rwanda, issues of aflatoxin. It's a major issue in Malawi. And the way we try to address it in this particular case is trying to figure out what options are locally available. Malawi right now is also trying to figure out different local solutions on how to do speed tests to check whether, you know, aflatoxin is, available or is present in different products or commodities that are harvested. We've been trying to see if there's other options such as packing in nice bags, but it's quite expensive for the local farmers. So coming up with local solutions, whether it's speed tests, I think, in my opinion, is the most relevant solution right now.
Great. Thanks, Maya. Anybody else want to talk about the issue of food safety? Maybe one of our Sight and Life colleagues?
Yeah, Simon, I could maybe share. So the hubs could promote, but also showcase upcoming and at least tested innovations, which are field friendly and can be, and which are very cost effective, that can be used, especially in countries where there's a lot of laboratory capacity. So we do have field-friendly technologies that either can be tested by the farmers themselves, or the middlemen who purchase, or the traders that purchase from these farmers, but also in processing facilities which only have basic laboratory setup, they can also use these field-friendly technologies right in their labs and test the quality of the food produce. And a lot of such innovations are usually not known widely, which is where I see the role of an innovation hub coming in, is to make sure that such innovations are widely known and then made available.
Great, thanks. Let's move on to the next question so we can get through a few more. The next question is about the Food Summit. Various of us have mentioned the Food Summit. And Uthrin, maybe I can turn to you on this one and say, how do you see these Food System Innovation Hub concepts and the other Food Innovation Hub concepts fitting in with the UN Food System Summit?
I think the idea of the hubs is spot on with the UNFSS, the Food System Summit. What the Food System Summit is looking to build is a series of game-changing solutions that can provide the opportunity for changing the food system to make it more sustainable. And the hubs are that type of a game-changing, scalable, replicable initiative that could potentially very positively impact food system activities across the globe. And for that reason, I think we should support the highlighting of the hubs in the food system narrative.
Great, thank you very much. Okay, let me move on to the next question. The next question is about how complex food transformation or food system transformation can be, and how important it is to have enabling policies and social movements to be able to support it, especially as we heard from a number of you as speakers, this need to make sure it's culturally and socially relevant to local communities. So what is the role that innovation hubs would play in terms of getting involved in and contributing to those local needed transformations? And maybe, Britta, I'll come back to you because you'd also talked a little bit about the need for responsible policies. And then maybe, Amar, you might have some views on this point as well.
Yeah, thanks, Simon. So I think this is the key, to go back to that whole area of engagement and bringing people together when it comes to the idea of the Food Systems Innovation Hub. Because I think, you know, we often talk about partnerships and we throw the word around quite a lot, but actually real partnerships are few and far between currently. So I think we have a lot of work to do to start to really, break out of our silos and bring all of these partners together. And I think that's one of the really unique roles that this hub could play. I think it's also important to remember that there's so many challenges for SMEs. So I think I work a lot in Rwanda and Ghana with SMEs, and you know, they're in a different place to what we are simply when it comes to actually getting to that affordable, nutritious food mantra that we talk about. And so we have to also understand it from sit in their shoes, right, and understand what they need to get to what we're asking. For example, we often have an issue in Ghana with our project Obasima, where we can't test any of the food products for micronutrient levels anywhere in Ghana. So it comes back to Germany to be tested. So these types of things are the day-to-day things that food companies are dealing with, and that we need to be able to provide solutions. I mean, it's not sustainable to be testing food in Germany when it's made in Ghana or Rwanda, for example. So I think this connection is really important and will be really important when it comes to if we really want to transform the food system.
Thanks, Amar.
Yeah, thanks. No, I think, you know, the purpose of these hubs is precisely to make some of these connections across, you know, government, civil society, industry, and the consumer. So if you just take a couple of examples, so the example of aflatoxin was mentioned, it tends to kind of, one of the reasons why it's so hard to crack is because it goes across so many different parts of the food system, from, you know, the farmer knowing, you know, how to you know, cultivate the seeds in the right way so the plant is healthy, through to harvesting, post-harvest processing, storage, processing, and in the end, consumer awareness. Because if consumers aren't, you know, clamoring for aflatoxin-free food, then, you know, there's not really much of an incentive for industry to do that. So that's where you then need more regulation. So just that one issue has multiple touch points. Another one would be mandatory fortification of staples, a pretty easy, one might think, sort of quick win in the world of nutrition to, you know, enhance somewhat the status of the food people eat every day. But again, it's a complex one. You know, it's not just about the regulation, it's about the consumer's understanding, you know, what this is and why it's helpful, the manufacturers being able to dose correctly and again understand how to market and blend the fortification, and all the, you know, various supply chain issues as well. So I would see the hubs playing a role in connecting some of these dots, which are very hard for any individual player to do, and which is what, you know, systemic change is ultimately about, is connecting those dots and getting everyone aligned in the same direction.
Great, thanks, Amar. I think we just have more time for one more question, and there's a question about how this gets sequenced. So there's a number of, as we heard, a number of other hub initiatives, but from Sight and Life perspective, and from this more, let's say, nutrition-focused, nutrition-led food system hub perspective that you guys have, you know, how do you think, I mean, I'm sure Maya would love to have one in Malawi, for example, Amar would like to have one in Rwanda, you know, I mean, there's going to be a lot of demand. So how do you decide where to go first? And then how quickly do you think you can replicate? And maybe Kalpana, I can look at you to just answer that briefly, but Ethrin, I'd love to get your view on this as well, particularly as an investor where you're looking for these opportunities. You know, what do you think they should do?
As of now, to keep our lives simple, because we've had brilliant interactions with a range of stakeholders and partners who are interested in the hub concept, we are looking at two criteria for the moment. One is the country readiness, and the second is our own capacity and coordination with a range of partners. In terms of country readiness, there are conversations that are happening with WEF, the World Economic Forum in India, and there's an upcoming workshop where I think nutrition could play a brilliant role in with the farmer-led model that WEF and our partners are trying to set up in India. And the virtual hub conversations are currently ongoing in Nigeria, where Ndidi is leading these conversations. And besides these, what we're also realizing that we have so much of knowledge already available through our programs that it might make sense to slowly convert this knowledge into a digital platform and start sharing with the current networks, whether it is in Rwanda, Ethiopia, Nigeria, or India. That's a I think I have a more simplified view to this very complex question, Simon.
Thanks, Kavana. Ethrin, just a couple of quick thoughts from your side.
Really quick, and just to build on what Kapna was saying, because I think that the direction that you're taking with the hubs is exactly the right one, ensuring that you can build the physical spaces where the opportunity exists, but creating those digital spaces that allow for networking across the entire community of interest, wherever the hubs are located, is exactly what we need. What we need is to ensure access to information for all of those who are working and to benefit from the development of this network and system to as many supporters as possible. And that's exactly what the hub is now. By launching in this manner, that's the opportunity we have to achieve. So congratulations to the hub for going about it in this manner.
Thanks, Ethrin. Just before I hand over to Klaus to close, let me just share one or two quick thoughts from my own perspective. As you heard from those of you who were on at the beginning, my introductory remarks, I'm a great believer as well in these very integrated and holistic solutions to these very complex problems. I'm also a great believer in standing on the shoulders of others who've gone before and already achieved a lot. So I think, you know, back to what you both were both saying, I think let's go where the energy is. Let's be responsive to demand. Let's be responsive to needs rather than trying to invent something in a, you know, relatively less fertile environment. At least approve the model and move it forward. So full support from my side for that perspective. Klaus, over to you for your closing remarks. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks very much to all the panelists for all your contributions.
Yeah, thank you, Simon, and thank you from the panel. It was a really fascinating discussion, and I would have wished to listen much longer to you, and regretted we have to come to a close now. And really thank you all for participating today, and all your insightful suggestions during today's webinar. Simon, we are really glad that we can work with you on this initiative, and we are extremely grateful to the support that we have seen now over the last couple of weeks discussing with some stakeholders on this initiative. And I'm really grateful to our speakers and panelists, and certainly also the overwhelming participation and the positive response that has come from all of you in the chat and the Q&A. And I'm pretty sure you are very interested in our plans to gain traction in the Food Systems Innovation Hub initiative in the run-up of the Food Systems Summit in September, as Ethrin alerted, because I think this is a unique opportunity. The more noise we are generating towards the Food Systems Summit from different angles and different forms of hubs, the more they will listen to us and would select this initiative as one of these bold, game-changing initiative. Mm-hmm. Yeah, just recently entered the idea of food system innovation hubs in the action tracks for the Food Systems Summit as a game-changing initiative for sustainable, responsive, and resilient food systems. And we are also now working on a paper, a food system summit brief submitted to the scientific group of the food system summit, which will include a layout of food innovation hubs and their initiative, the plethora that was talked about today. And we really intend now to establish a working group and invite engagement from businesses, governments, private and public donors, investors and consumer groups. They are all needed around the table to further flesh out the concept. And in my opinion, the first action will be a country readiness assessment. And we hope to have your support as the Food Systems Innovation Hub initiative unfolds. And I'd like to remind you of five key action areas to join and be part of the coordinated effort to improve the food systems worldwide. First, technical support to make labs and equipment and knowledge easily available to small and medium-sized companies in low and middle-income countries to support the development and production of high-quality, nutritious, and affordable food that is safe and tasty, as we heard quite a few times today, which is a significant gap in this food system. Second, capacity building, building an environment around nutritious food pertaining to food quality and safety, nutrition assessment, and the workforce, among others, that is needed to work on a sustainable and safe and nutritious food system. Third, outreach to support creation and dissemination of effective strategies through advocacy, consumer insights, and marketing. Fourth, investment in local companies, and I'm glad that Adrian was able to join us today in order to nurture innovations with seed funding and technical support. And fifth, policy to engage local policymakers and collaborate on a roadmap to the future to create a unified voice and to drive ideas on enhancing regulations and standards. It is only through true partnership, in my opinion, and a coordinated action that the Food Systems Innovation Hub initiative will succeed. So please really join us to invest, inspire, and innovate. And I also would like you to invite to stay in touch, and we will share updates on the progress we are making over time. And really thank you for being with us today and look forward to continue working with you all on the call. Thank you.